I'm just laughing at you because you're fucking, you're a weird little man.
Do you think I'm odd? Tell the truth.
Yes, I think you're odd. That's why I'm your friend.
Like, I like how I said tell the truth like you weren't going to tell
me. Of course I think you're odd. That's why I like you. You're funny. You think outside the box. That's why I was like, that's why I like that you're homeschooled, because you're not like everybody else. Like, you have this different thought process.
Yeah.
You know, that's like why you're
but
just
But do you think that
guy.
Often? Because you don't agree with a lot of things I say, or the things that I do or say, or like my reasoning for things. You're like, why do you do that?
Because I don't get upset with it. You're just my favorite silly little idiot. Like, that's like, that's what you are. When, like, I like it because what you interrupt me with, like, the dumbest, funniest thing at the
do
same
time.
Do I? Yeah, sometimes, you know? Like,
what do you mean I interrupt you?
Oh, man, like, okay. I actually wrote a joke about this. Like,
about how I interrupt you?
Yeah, not interrupt me. I'm just talking about, like, if I'm busy, all of a sudden, okay. Like, because my work is hectic. And then all of a sudden, I get a text in this from you. And I'll be like, I'll look and it'll just say, Kev. And I'm like, oh, my God. I'm like, yeah. And you're like, what's up? And it's, instead of getting to the point when things are really hectic. But sometimes you just bring up funny, stupid shit that it's just like, I'm so, like, glad I have a dumb idiot friend, because it just makes life better.
Do you know how often people tell me, like, dude, just text me what you want?
Yeah, just text it. Like, it's like, oh my God, it's like trying to figure out a chick. Like, when it's just like, hey, Kev.
You know, even Jen, it's like, sometimes I'll text her like, hey, and she'll just right away already go to the attitude, and I actually get pissed at her, like, why you have an attitude with me? Like, she right away just goes to the attitude. Like, when I go, hey, she goes like, what? Like, with exclamation points. I'm like, geez, what's your problem? Because she's like, I know what you're about to do. You're about to go, hey, and then I'd wait for me to say, hey, and then, like, let's just get to the point.
Yeah.
What is it? What do you want?
That is, like, the weirdest thing you do, but I like it at the same time, no matter how much it gets on my nerves. Like, if I'm stressed out at work, because my job is, like, really stressful, and when you do that, yeah. Like, I get mad, but then I just start laughing. I'm like, because it's something that you'll never stop doing, but
I don't see anything wrong with it.
You don't, but it's just that's what's funny about it. No, because
but
you
wonder if most people
you
think
text,
it's weird.
You text how people talk in person.
Because that's how it's going in my mind.
Yeah, but that's not like, give me the immediate
I
information.
I even imagine how it's going to go. Like, I'm going to say hi, and you're going to text me back and be like, hey, what's up? And then I'm going to tell you. Like, that's how it's supposed to go.
That's so funny. Man, everybody, whenever anybody texts me, they just get right to it. Like, you would have like 15 sentences just to say, what are you doing Saturday night?
I would.
You would. When other people, it's just the very first text. Hey, Kev, Saturday night, I'm having a party. Come over. All right, cool. But you're like, hey, what's up? What are you doing? How are you feeling?
I know why I do it. There's two reasons why I do it. And I like do them on purpose, but I don't anymore because now it's just how I do it. But I do it because, first of all, I don't like to just hit people up for something. I like to, like, ease into it. Like, I learned a long time ago, like, don't just say, like, hey, do you have this thing I can borrow? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you text people and you go, hey, how are you? How's everything?
Well, that's for people you don't talk to all the time. You talk to me almost every fucking day. You know what I mean?
So with people like you, it's the other reason. Like, for you and my wife, it's the other reason. Because I said there's two reasons, right? The other reason is that I know that people ignore text messages.
Yeah, I ignore yours purposely until you just get
right
to the point.
You already know how I do it, though.
Yeah.
But I know that, like, if I text you and say, like, something, I don't know, whatever. Like, what are you doing Saturday? Or, like, hey, are you free tonight? You want to come podcast? Whatever the fuck. If I just text someone that randomly, I know, first of all, like, if I don't get a response back for a while, I'm going to think, they don't like me. They don't want to come over and podcast. They don't want to hang out with me on Saturday because they're not answering and they don't know how to tell me.
See, I get what you're saying, but I also hate that too, because I hate how much technology makes us immediately available. Like, back in the day, before, you would have to leave a message and, like, all right, I'll get to it. Because sometimes it's just not an insult. Like, it's like, I got shit I got to do right now. I'll explain it to you afterwards. It shouldn't be. I mean, it's texting. It's just give me a quick message.
Yeah.
Don't send me that. Yeah. The hi,
well,
how
I
are
want
you?
A quick message. Yeah. But people don't. I'll ask you a question, Kevin, what are you doing Saturday? And then I don't get an answer for hours.
You know what this reminds me of?
And then it fucking freaks me out. So you know what I want to do? I want to text hey first, and then you text me back, hey, what up? Now I know I have your attention. Then I drop it on you. And I do the same thing with my wife. I say, like, hi, and she's like, hi, what's up? How are you? And then I just go, like, boom, here it is. And then if you don't answer me after that, then I know it's not that you weren't by your phone. It's simply that you just don't like my idea.
It reminds me of that episode of The Office when Michael is trying to call corporate. And I think it was David Wallace. And he's just like, what's wrong, Michael? You just sent me a message saying 911. Oh, yeah. If I don't say it's an emergency, you won't call me back. So
yeah, he texts me 911. Yeah. He's like, I learned a long time ago, people usually don't call me back unless they text 911. Yeah. That's not what I'm doing.
But no, but it's funny too, because sometimes, like, this is a joke I made about you once. And like one time at like 2 o'clock in the morning, you texted me, hey, are you awake? Like I was going to get that text message inside my dream. You know what I mean? Like, it's just like, if I like, why am I going to answer that question? If I answer that question, that means I'm awake. It's,
well,
just
that's
like,
something
why
that
ask,
people ask you even when you're in person.
Are you awake?
You ever have a sleepover with friends or with, like, I don't know, you ever share a room with siblings?
Oh, no, yeah, yeah.
You share a room with your brother. You guys are laying there and you go, hey, are you awake?
Yeah.
It's the same thing.
It was just fun. It was just funny. That's why I like how you're socially awkward, but you're socially awkward in a good way. You're like too outgoing.
It's not even outgoing.
What's that?
It's not even outgoing.
Yes, it is, because like you just talk to everybody like you're their best friend.
Maybe over text. But I do realize, I know that I do that, and I told you I had those reasons, but yeah. I do probably think that people that I text throughout the day probably think I'm so fucking weird, who don't know me as well as you do.
Yeah, well, that's just like, it's fun though.
Because I get people that like are so, some people try not to show it, but some people will like, they'll just text me back and be like, did you just text me hi and then nothing else? Like, yeah. And it's people I don't even talk to every day. They're like, hey, like, what's up?
I'm going to start doing that. I'm just going to start texting hey to people.
Yeah.
And then never text them back ever again in my life.
And then once I have your attention, I'll talk. I'll say what I want to say.
It better be worth the buildup. That's all I got to say.
It's not even that much buildup. It's, hi, how are you?
Yeah.
You know?
That sounds more suspicious of somebody trying to, like, break the ice so they can ask you for something. That sounds like some people, like, just give it to me. What do you want? You know what I mean? Like, that's what it is. But
like,
whatever.
When you're a kid and you go up to your parents and you're just like, hey, like, you need any help around the kitchen?
Hey, Mom, you look great today.
What do you want?
Yeah.
It's not always that I'm asking for something.
No.
It might be that I want to pass information along or just chat. But I don't want to get myself all in. I hate releasing a paragraph or releasing, like, a thought or just a little part of a chat. And then no one's on the other line. I want to make sure you're there first before I have a conversation.
All right, I get you. No, that makes total sense. And I'm not ragging on you. It's just funny.
You are.
I am, but it's just funny. It's funny.
No, because we have like the group chat with friends.
Yeah, with our the two High McFly guys.
Haven't you ever noticed that I've never done that there? I don't text in there like, hi, guys, and wait for someone to reply and then start.
Well, it's because we're constantly on there. It's like our constant group chat that is constantly
going on. There's
always
someone on there.
I know, but it's fun, though. I love having that. That is like the one thing about social media that I like.
But that's a group, though, dude. Like, that's
I know. Because it's in the Messenger, and I don't have the notifications. Otherwise, I'd get like 5,000 in an hour. Mm. It's just like a constant chat with, like, you're talking with your best friends all day long. You know
what
I mean?
And there it's like common stuff. Like, maybe I saw a funny picture. I'll throw it in there and someone's gonna see it.
Yeah.
But with you, or if I'm having a conversation one-on-one, I want to say, like, hello.
Oh, we got to tell them about our gift battles.
All right, go ahead.
Our gift battles is when we get into heated arguments in our Messenger, whether it's about a movie or something like that, and we come up with a dummy. Like, we were fighting today about Elizabeth Shue, if she's naturally brunette or naturally blonde.
Which, by the way, if you guys have an input on this, feel free to hit me up.
I'm not talking about now. I'm talking about Elizabeth Shue from Karate Kid.
First of all, if you look at her now, you can just tell that she's a blonde.
I know, but
it's... But you can't really call it because she's older now and she probably dyes it.
She definitely dies. She's been dyeing her hair for a long time. Now, it was all about, like, that she's naturally blonde, because you can tell, I mean, tell with her eyebrows that she has brown hair and her roots, it's just so brown. It's just the very top layer is, like, dusty blonde.
Listen, bro,
but anyway, so we're getting into the gift battles. Yeah. So whenever we get into
a heated
argument...
Wait, really quick, if people want to chime in their vote here, I say that Elizabeth Shue is blonde. Kevin says that she's a brunette. I just think that she's a darker blonde.
No, you kept on saying blonde. That's what I was trying to say. Dirty no, she's blonde, blonde is not dirty blonde is not blonde.
Dirty blonde is blonde.
No, it's not.
It's considered a blonde.
Dirty blonde. Anyway, is I'm not going to get into his argument
here right now, but and if you guys don't know who Elizabeth Shue is, she's from the part one of Karate Kid, that chick, his
Back
girlfriend
to the
in
Future
it.
Two and
Back
three.
To the Future Part. Well, she dyed her hair brown for that, obviously.
Yeah, right.
To match the other actress.
So she didn't blonde dye her hair blonde for a Karate Kid.
No, that's her natural hair color.
It is, but I'm just saying the top.
Listen, I'm not going to argue this. We already argued for like 2 hours today about it. And she's in Adventures of Babysitting. Anyway, guys, you fucking tell me. But anyway, gift battle.
Okay, so gift battle. So that's what would kick off a gift battle, where if you guys don't know what gifts are, I mean, I think everybody does. It's like the small moving pictures, almost like vines, but it's usually from movies or just something fun.
Yeah, they're a couple seconds.
Yeah, so instead of actually talking, arguing, we throw gift battles, like round one, like it's kind of like a shit talking one, so you got to find gifts that are shit talking,
right?
And then they choose the winner of that round. Then
round two is actual hitting,
is
like
actual
striking.
Hitting, yeah, you know what I mean, any type of physical type of,
yeah,
like
find, like Superman punching Batman or
yeah
something,
yeah,
like that.
It's just something that, you know. And then the third round is the knockout round, so it's not just fighting, it's like an actual knockout, like you're done.
It's a free-for-all too, you can use weapons,
yeah, it's anything as long as it's like a knockout blow.
It's pretty fun and stupid.
Yeah.
And then, and then, like, you know, the other people in the group, they'll like be judges, so we'll find out who really wins.
And then we spend most of the time arguing over how they scored it.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway,
they've been pretty unjust.
That's a fun way to
and
kick
I refuse
off.
To gift battle you on the Elizabeth Shue thing, because I'm not gonna lose.
I'm not gonna lose either. I'm not
because
gonna
I know she's
defeat.
A blonde.
She's brown. She has brown hair. She has brown hair with blonde highlights naturally from the sun.
You know what, bro? Let's smoke these bowls and start this podcast. All right.
That was a good, fun introduction. We can't do it at the same time.
I have your lighter?
Yeah. There we go. You like the pizza slices on my lighter?
I love it. I just didn't want to say anything and make it weird.
Why would that make it weird?
I don't know. I'm just fucking with you, bro. Just messing around. I love your pizza lighter. Anyway, go ahead and smoke your little bowl, dude. Wait, before you do it, let me hit my one more time, and I'll read the sponsors while you're smoking yours.
All right, sounds good to me. I think we should also talk some more about stand-up comedy today, too. What do you think?
Hell yeah.
All right.
Can you believe this is episode 111? It's episode 111. This episode.
My birthday is January 11th.
Oh my god! And you're my special guest today, bud.
Holy shit, right there, dude.
There you go. It's meant to be.
There we go.
This episode is brought to you by BullyMake.com. You guys.
I thought you were gonna say Kevin's birthday.
BullyMake.com. You guys. It's a delivery service right to your door. It's a monthly subscription, or you don't have to do monthly. You could just try it one time if you want. They send you a box. It's got some treats for your puppy in there. So imagine the concept of Blue Apron, you know, things like that, stuff that sends you clothes, stuff that sends you food or healthy treats, but it's for your dog. They send you 2 to 3 toys for your dog, and it's called Bully Make because they specify in, like, with those bulldogs or dogs that just can rip toys apart really easily. Like, mine's a pit bull, you know, Rottweilers, Dobermans, Shepherds, whatever you have. Whatever your breed is, your dog's breed is, like, if you find your dog is just going through the toys and just ripping apart in the first couple of days, BullyMake.com is for you. Also, they'll include in the same box 3 to 4 different treats. I don't mean like individual like samples of treats. I mean like the fucking bag of treats. I use this for my dog. It's awesome. The best part about it for me anyway, because my dog has allergies and he has like super sensitive skin and stomach problems. You can actually go on there and say like my dog is allergic to this, or he has allergies with weather conditions, or he has like a weak stomach, and they'll send you the appropriate treats. So that's BullyMake.com. You can sign up for a year, you can sign up for 6 months, or you can just say, you know, I only want to do one box and see how I like it. Either way, whatever you decide to do, you're going to use promo code HOME, H-O-M-E, HOME, as in homeschooled podcast, HOME, and that'll get you $10 off your order no matter what you decide to do. Also, I'd like to introduce a brand new sponsor to the podcast. This is FreshRoastedCoffee.com. Same concept, guys. Right to your door service. Did I tell you last week, Kevin, that I did a week without coffee?
No.
That was my cleaning out the attic for the week.
I started drinking green tea.
Have you, instead of coffee?
Yeah.
I drank a lot of tea to get me through that week. And you know what, man? Like, I'm going back to coffee after I finished my week, but I used to have 3 cups a day, and now I'm like around 2, and I'll probably do it again later on, give it up for a week. And the more you give stuff up, the less you want it when you go back, you know? I think I'll try to like incorporate tea in. Green tea's like pretty healthy. But either way, it's super important to know what you're putting in your body. If you're going to consume something that much, you should know where the fuck it comes from, right? Like, I drink a lot of coffee. I'm sure a lot of people do. Freshroastedcoffee.com, you guys, it's all organic, fresh grown. They deliver it right to your door. There's no minimum purchase necessary. If you want, you can go in there and you can order pods if you use like the Keurigs, you know, and they'll send you pods. Or you can go in there and just get a bag of the grounded coffee beans. And that, I mean, honestly, there's bags in there starting at like $8 and there's no minimum purchase. Just, you know, order. They have tea, fresh grown tea. They have green coffee made from green beans instead of like the brown beans, a little bit healthier. Everything's all on there. And most importantly, you're knowing what you're consuming. It's all organic. And most importantly, you're supporting the Homeschooled podcast. So it's freshroastedcoffee.com. And at checkout, you're going to use the homo code. You're going to use the promo code. I was thinking home. You're going to use the promo code school. That's the promo code.
Oh, now it's different. People are going to get it mixed up. So coffee is school and bully mate is home.
Okay. So this one is school, not schooled, school. So just the word school, that's going to get you 10% off your entire order. And no minimum purchase necessary. Also, don't forget, if you guys, Father's Day is just around the corner. A great gift for dad might be a new watch. I love my new watch from dmcwatch.com, guys. Don't just go to the website if you want to support the podcast. If you're thinking about getting a new watch or at least checking it out, make sure you use the link in the description. Just click on it or copy and paste it, whatever you got to do. That's the link so that our podcast gets credit if you go check it out. It's the DeLorean Motor Company, guys. They made the DeLorean car. It's badass. It's unique. It's one of a kind. Not everybody has it. I'm the only person that has ever had it that I've met so far. And I get compliments all the time, especially if your dad's like a fan of movies from the 80s, or one of my greatest memories is watching like Back to the Future with my dad. So like, it's one of my favorite movies. It's just so cool that I got it. You know, it says official product of DMC, DeLorean Motor Company. On the back, you got the little emblem of the DeLorean car. It's stainless steel. It's really fucking awesome. It's not going to cost you thousands of dollars like all these watches, like a fucking Ferrari watch. Fucking go DMC and be different.
DMC?
DMC watch, DeLorean Motor Company. Click the link in the description. That's all the sponsors, guys.
That was a lot, man. We're getting a lot of sponsors.
This is the Homeschooled Podcast. I'm Agostino Zoida.
I'm Kevin Lyons.
Let's do this. Cut my life into pieces. Yeah. This is my last resort. Suffocation, no breathing. Is it close enough? I want it loud. That's, whenever you say that, I listen to it later in the car and it sounds like shit.
Okay.
You gotta do? I want them to fucking bleed. I want their speakers to break right now.
You want that Papa Roach effect.
Yeah.
Nothing like jamming out to Papa Roach and drinking Coors Light beer. That's only be. Why did you get Coors Light? It's taken me forever to finish these.
Speak for yourself, bro. That's the last one.
I know.
And good riddance.
Good riddance.
Get them the fuck out of here.
Bye bye, Coors.
Jeez. That was weird. We were both coughing at the same time.
Yeah. How's it going?
It's going good, dude. So I haven't gotten to talk to you on the on the podcast about like what the fuck to catch you up.
Catch me up, dude.
Yeah. So I had to go to Sacramento, right? I did some shows.
Yeah.
Okay. So on my way there, like, first of all, that morning when I woke up, I was fucking sick.
Yeah.
Like, I woke up with a sore throat. And then, like, I was actually contemplating, like, canceling going and doing the shows, canceling the whole weekend because I was supposed to go for my sister's birthday. She lives in Sacramento. She's turning 40. I'm like, I got to go. She's having, like, a big party. I'm like, plus, I'll get to do some spots and do some shows. And I'm like, I might cancel it. But then, like, by the afternoon, I felt a little better. You know, I took some medicine and shit. And then I just get in the car and start driving. You know, it's a six-hour drive.
This is when I was dog-sitting Carmen.
Right. This is not last weekend, but the weekend before that.
Yeah.
So it's a six-hour drive to Sacramento, bro. About hour four, it just fucking hit me, dude, hard. Like, fever.
Oh,
like
really?
Like, bad, man. Bad flu symptoms, dude.
And that's a tough drive to get sick on, man.
Six hours?
It's forever,
dude. The first couple hours, I was doing okay. I was listening to music, and the time was going by quick. And then all of a sudden, man, 4 hours in, I started to get, like body aches in my legs and shit. I mean, you know when you have a bad flu? Like, those kind of symptoms, bro. Like, fucking, like, cold sweats. I started to get, like just my throat hurting, fever. I, like you know when your legs are shaking, like shivering, like your teeth are chattering, but it's not cold.
Holy shit, man!
Like that, I was like, "Fuck!" And I never let Jen drive, like when we're going on like a road trip or something. She's always like, "Hey, do you want me to drive for a little while?" I'm like, "Fuck no!" Like, I get car sick. I don't like when anybody else drives, especially on a long trip. But like at that point, I'm like, I don't really have a choice. Like, I cannot do this drive anymore. So we pulled over, and she took over for the rest of the 2 hours, and I was going directly to a comedy club. So 6 hours in the car going right to a comedy club. Then I was going to, after the comedy club, going to go to my sister's house, sleep, you know.
How far from the comedy club to your sister's house?
25, 30 minutes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. She lives like maybe 25 minutes outside of Sacramento. So I had her drive the rest of the way, man. And I pulled up in front of the comedy club. She dropped me off. She's like, "Hey, you go do the spot." She's like, "I'm going to go to CVS and like get you everything that you fucking need for this weekend." I was seriously contemplating. This is how bad it was, bro. At that moment, I was contemplating buying a flight, like buying a ticket home and just fucking leaving my car. Really? Or I would just have like Jen drive it back. With, you know, with like my sister or something, when I'm like, dude, I don't know if I can get through this. Like, I don't know if I can spend the weekend at someone else's house. Like, it was that bad, bro.
Oh, man.
So I got out of the car and I was driving, so I didn't have my jacket on. And then when I got out of the car, it was like cold and I was like fucking shaking, dude. Fever. I put my jacket on. I walked into the comedy club and I was just literally saying to myself, I have no clue how I'm going to go do this set right now. Like, no clue.
And did you do it?
Yeah, I had to do it.
Fuck yeah.
What do you do?
Fuck yeah.
Sometimes you gotta.
Here we go. Cheers with my Coors Light and your water. Same thing.
Sometimes you gotta man up and you just gotta get through that shit.
Yeah.
I've always thought, like, before you're a comic, you ever wonder, like, what do you do on sick days? You can't call out at work sick. I mean, if it's a stupid bullshit show that doesn't pay you around the corner and it's easy for them to have someone else replace you, or they already have, like, a pretty stacked lineup anyway.
Yeah.
It's not like you were the only one they're relying on. You can cancel stuff, but like, bro, sometimes you're under contract. Sometimes people are expecting you. And I had to drove 6 hours.
To tell a joke sick.
And not only that, so that club that I was doing that night, like the first night when I got there, that was the one I was auditioning for, like showcasing for. Because that's a club I've been trying to get into for a while. I already do, like, the Punchline out there. Uh-huh. That's, like, one of the major clubs.
Yeah.
But this other one, I wanted to, like, start to work it. I would really like them to headline me, or at least, like, let me try me out as a feature one time. Because my sister lives right there. I can just literally stay for the whole weekend and just work.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very strict at this place. Like, they're just like, we don't let you headline until you featured here. We don't let you feature here until you've emceed here. And we don't let you MC here until we've seen you do, like, a guest spot. And I'm like, can't you just, like, ask the club, like, three blocks down that's, like, way better club than you are? Like, it's, like, way better names in there. Like, don't you see that I work there? Like, I wish they communicated. Or, like, fucking, can I send you a video or something? But I knew I was going to be in town, and I said, let me come by and do a guest spot. And they told me I could.
Yeah.
They told me you do, like, 7 minutes.
Okay.
You know, man, sometimes you have to deal with this bullshit. Besides that fact that I'm sick and I had no idea how I was going to get through the set. I go there and the headliner was this comic who was a friend of mine. And I was talking to him at the bar. And he's like, yeah, I think it's going to go like the host, some chick, and then you. I'm like, okay. So when they start the show, I was still sitting at the bar having a tea. I was actually drinking tea.
Yeah.
And the guy who's supposed to be like, watching my set, he comes out and he was like, you better get in there. A show started. And I was like, oh, I thought that there's one more in than me. And he goes, no, they're bringing you up first. And he goes, don't miss your opportunity, bro. Like, that's kind of like how he was talking to me. I just want to be like, dude, like, fucking really? Do you really have to act like that? I hate when people try to act like, when they know you want something, like, oh, they get, like, this power, like, oh, yeah, you're auditioning for me, you're showcasing me. Like, dude, relax. You're not fucking Simon Cowell. You're not fucking Mitzi Shore.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ, dude. You're not even, like, the biggest, most major comedy club in the city. And, like, I walked in there, you know, watch a couple of other – I mean, don't disrespect anybody, but, I mean, I never heard of any of those people in my life. I watched the other comics that were first, and there was, like, bro, you're giving me a hard time, and this is who you book?
Yeah.
Like, dude, they were fucking awful. Like, just, like, what are you guys doing in here?
Well, how did your set go, though?
So I went on about stage. I fucking murdered it, bro. I have no idea how I got the energy to do that. I can't imagine, like, how I fucking did it. I just did it.
Sometimes the adrenaline just takes over. It doesn't matter how sick you get.
I was counting on it. Yeah. Like, I was hoping that would happen once I got up there. But I didn't really know. I've been sick before on stage. I've never been that sick. Like, day one of the flu symptoms and, like, fever.
Yeah.
I've never been on stage with it, so I didn't know how I was going to go. But the dude left me up there for 15 minutes. He didn't like me. And I was fucking killing it, bro. I had a great set.
It's so funny what the adrenaline of going on stage can do. It can heal anything. You can get shot and just be like, don't bring me to the hospital. Get me on stage. Get me on stage. I'll be fine.
If you were killing in a packed crowd, like a decent-sized crowd,
yeah,
and then like afterwards you got shot, it'd probably be a little less painful.
Because like, all your adrenaline is coursing through your body that the bullets just bounce off you.
Like Selena didn't feel shit.
That's was so awful. Fucked up. That was fucking awful.
I gotta say it, bro.
I can't believe you said that.
Didn't she get shot on stage?
I don't even want to talk about it anymore.
Or right after she got off stage. I don't know. But anyway, yeah, dude. And then I got off stage and I told the guy, I was like, hey, I'm sorry. Did I run the light? I'm like, I thought I was only doing like 7. And I go, I didn't see a light. So I just kept going. And by the way, while I was on stage, I was in the room. I even got like an applause break. Like, I'm like, I'm rocking this right now. Like, I hope the guy's watching. I even said like, hey, it was like minute 10, and I'm like, hey guys, anybody in the room? I haven't gotten a light yet. You guys want me to keep going? No one put a light. No one said anything. I go, fuck it. Guess I'm going to keep going. The audience, like, clapped, and I kept going. And then I was like, hey, I didn't mean to run the light. Did I run the light or anything? He's like, oh, sorry, dude. He's like, I had to, like, run in the back, and I kind of just, like, left you up there for a bit. I'm like, so you didn't watch my set?
I was about to say, oh, look at you. You should have been there. This is your one opportunity to audition me.
You fucked up my opportunity. Like, you didn't even fucking watch my set. I drove 6 hours.
Oh, you know he did. He was just saying that because he was a dick to you before, and he didn't want to fucking...
Maybe, man.
No, that's exactly what happened.
So, dude, I fucking drove 6 hours, sick. I got a fever right now, and I still did this show, and all your comics are fucking weak. And I went up there and I got this room.
There you go, buddy. Good for you.
Yeah.
Did you start to feel better after that?
No. I felt like shit. Did you notice like when we were talking on the phone that I was like fucking out of it?
I didn't. I barely even talked to you on the phone. I just talked to you via text.
No, we talked on the phone. Like the next morning, you were asking me stuff about my dog and stuff like that.
Yeah,
you remember that?
My voice sounded all weird. You just sounded like you just woke up.
Nah, dude. I was fucking dying. And like the next day I ended up like just taking a bunch of pills and I slept all day and I was fine by night.
Nice.
And I was like sick all week. And then,
dude, what is up with that water? It's spilling all over the table.
Dude, there might be like a little hole in it or something.
Yeah, there's definitely a little hole. Finish. There's like a sip left.
I don't know. It's leaking out. Look at my pants.
All right. So was that about Sacramento? That was it.
That was it about Sacramento.
Yeah, fuck that guy. Did they call you back?
No. I emailed them the following Monday, and I was like, thank you very much for the opportunity. Thanks for having me in your club. I'd like to fucking, you know, be able to work there next time. I didn't get no answer.
Fuck it.
Yeah. And I know it's not that I wasn't good. I'm not trying to sound arrogant or cocky. I hope this doesn't come across as delusional. Because, like, some comics, they'll be like, man, I fucking killed it, and they didn't call me. And you're like, well, because you probably didn't kill it. But I honestly, like if you saw the other comics that they have working in that room, and you saw what I did to that room, come on. You know me, bro. I would fucking tell you if it didn't go well. So, I don't know.
Well, good for you.
They're stupid. I don't know. But who knows? Maybe they will eventually. I'll get more time. Maybe they'll book me in the future, which is why I'm not going to say their name. Because you never know. I might be doing it in the next couple months. I'll keep on them. Just got to keep on them. Just be like, hey, remember me? You got to do that shit, bro.
Yeah.
Fucking got to keep on people. It's hard to find the line between bugging people and like fucking keeping on them. It's a very fine line. And sometimes I think it's often crossed.
You're always bugging me. Thanks. We established that in the opening of this podcast.
Well, I know that like bookers will tell you, like, hey, like, don't not come say anything to me. Like, I'm not going to give you anything if you're not coming up to me and asking me. Like, you constantly have to be on me. And I'm like, okay. And then I also know that people complain when you bother them so much.
Well, then let me ask you, because, like, I guess a good amount of our fans are actually our listeners. They want to be comics, right?
I don't know. Maybe some do, maybe some don't.
Okay, well, what would you say – how would you get into a club that where you don't know the booker, like as a newer comic, and you want to start getting booked in this favorite club that you always want to get into? How do you do it?
Okay. What do you want to get into it? Like, you want to get booked there?
You want to get booked at a club where you don't know anybody who books it there. You know what I mean? Like, you just want it. You want to start doing shows there.
How long have you been doing comedy?
I don't know. I'm just in general. How would you go about going to get yourself booked into a club where you don't know anybody?
Because there's a huge difference. If you're an amateur, if you just started, yeah, you're going to want to start to find out that open mic.
Yep.
You know, go do some open mics. And then sometimes it's not good to do the open mic of the club that you want to get booked at, because, like, you don't want them to see you as an amateur.
Yeah.
Which is why I say it makes a difference, because of, like, a guy like me wouldn't go do that. Because why? They're already booking me. You know what I mean? Like, you don't want to, then they'll place you as an open micer, but you're not. You've been doing this 7, 10, whatever years, yeah, you know? So if you're new, go to a few open mics. You eventually start meeting other guys at open mics that have rooms, and eventually you just kind of will get better. And when you're ready, you could start going over there and hanging out. If you feel like you're maybe not brand new, but you're still like, you know, maybe a couple of years in.
Yeah.
But you feel like you have like a solid 5.
Yeah.
Go over to that club's open mic and do their solid 5 and just go every time they have an open mic. Don't go over there and try new shit like you would at the random open mics.
No, that's like this stuff where it basically would be like a show even though it's an open mic.
Exactly.
Like, you go to a different open mic to work on your material for the open mic of the club that you want to get into.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
The other day I told you I tried the Comedy Store open mic. I've never really done that before. But they know me well enough to where I can do that. I'm not worried about how they'll look at me. Yeah. I don't really do it that often. And besides that, they already put me up in friends and family every now and then when they can. And okay, the potluck on Monday. But if you're – let's say you're 7 years in, or maybe even less, 5, 4, and you're not – you still go to open mics, but you're a little bit better than an open micer per se. Let's say you move to a new city or a state and yeah, you want to start getting into that club. You don't want to start all over again.
Yeah.
From amateur status. The best way to do it is just to go there and show your face. But don't go there and show your face and then right away start asking, how can I get booked here?
Yeah, yeah.
Don't do that. Walk in. First of all, always be super nice to the employees,
mm-hmm,
because the employees are like the gatekeepers. Even the fucking door guy who checks IDs, be super nice to them. Don't walk in and go, I'm a comic.
Yeah.
Then they fucking hate your guts. You have to walk in. Even still to this day, in a city I've lived in my entire life, I go to comedy clubs. Like, you know what I mean? And I walk in, and still to this day, I if I don't know the door guy, I go, hey, what's up, man? I'm Agostino. How are you? Nice to meet you. Like, he thinks I'm a patron.
Yeah.
Like, if you could tell if someone doesn't recognize you, they think that, like, oh, excuse me, sir, how can we help you? I go up and go, hey, my name's Agostino. I shake his hand. Nice to meet you. What's your name? Devin. Cool. Nice to meet you, Devin. And then I go, like, I'm a comic. Can I come hang out at the bar and have a drink? That's pretty much how you do it.
Yeah.
Even though, like certain clubs, like Laugh Factory won't even let you in.
Yeah.
To, like, okay, hang out, yeah, for comics. They don't want you to do that. But that's pretty much what you do. You know, I do that at the improv all the time. Sometimes there's a new door guy and he goes like, you know, yeah, you should have a drink, you know. I feel like it's better to say, can I come have a drink at the bar and just hang out? It's better than saying, can I come in and hang out? I'm a comic, because then they're gonna be like, we don't really want comics like hanging out. What are you going to sneak into the showroom and shit like that? Just like, hey, can I come have a drink? I'm a comic. I want to hang out. You know, I'm meeting other comics here, whatever. So that's what you're going to do. You're new to a city. You go in, you walk in, you're friendly, you introduce yourself, and then you're not going to go up, who books it? Who books it right away? You're going to fucking go sit there, have a cocktail. You talk to the bartender. You know, you make conversation with bartenders like bartenders just like to talk to people.
It's so funny. The way you're describing this makes it sound like you're a private investigator. You got to blend into your surroundings.
You
okay?
do got to like scope it out, in. Bro.
You got to bring a newspaper up. To hold up so nobody can see your face.
You got to go like the day before.
Wear a fedora. Bring your fedora, leather jacket, and sunglasses.
You can't come across as aggressive or pushy. You sit there, you talk to the bartender, you know, you tip him well. Next time you go in there, he's going to remember you and you have a conversation again. Then he'll start to tell you, that guy's a comic. And then you're just talking to other comics at the bar. Then they'll tell you, that guy books it. And then after showing your face there a couple times in a row, then you're going to go up to the booker and say like, hey, I'm a comic, just moved to town. My name is blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to like bother you or anything tonight. Don't worry about it. I just want to introduce myself. And then walk, and then go back to the bar and finish your drink.
Yeah.
Then like go every week. Then eventually you start to be like, hey man, like how do I go about like kind of like showcasing for you? Or even better, can I get some other comics to refer you who work that club? A lot of clubs have different processes of how they take comics.
Yeah.
Some want to see a video or whatever, a clip. But a lot of them, they just go, like, by referral. So, like, if they have, two or three comics that work their club all the time and all three of them will vouch for you.
Yeah.
They'll give you a shot. That's like, cool. Okay, this is it. You know, so that's why it's good to just – even though you're trying to get into that one club that you really want to be in there.
Yeah.
That's why it's good to just go to a lot of different clubs.
And just meet people. Yeah. Because that's like, that's how I was doing it. back when I met you. Just go to a bunch of different open mics and clubs, and eventually the people running the open mics run a room somewhere.
Somewhere.
And if they like you, they'll just be like, oh, hey, man, do you want to, can you bring 10 people and you can be on my show at this
place? And odds are, sometimes some of them run a show during the week at the club that you want to be in.
Yeah.
And they've also seen you on stage because you get up in whatever bullshit rooms.
Yeah.
So they'll go like, hey, this guy's funny. And they'll put, and then before you know it, you know, you're getting up in front of the right people.
That's good.
Yeah.
So that's some ways how not to get yourself into a club. You can't go in there demanding. You can't go in there with a bomb strapped to your chest and say, give me the booker. What are some other big cardinal mistakes rookies make?
Fuck, man. Everything.
Like, do you have cardinal rules? Like, do not do this.
Not off the top of my head.
Not off the top of your head.
I mean, that's why they call him a rookie, though, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you're doing everything wrong.
But but there is something cool about being a rookie too. Like, before you have to start molding the way that you write your jokes, like anything could be a joke. You know what I mean? It's like that. It's that young hunger that's kind of fun about being a rookie. But
I'd say some good rules that rookies often make this mistake. So here's a couple to help you not. Hopefully, they really want too much too quick.
Yeah,
and they'll try to get booked at one of these clubs. And you don't want to be seen yet.
Yeah.
That's a huge mistake. Here's a huge, huge mistake. Sometimes when they're starting stand-up and they go to open mics for their first time, they invite their friends to that.
Oh, yeah. You know what? I did that once. The very first time I did stand-up comedy in Boston. And you know what's kind of funny? I did pretty well.
Sure you did well.
Because I had my friends in there. But it was obviously I wasn't great, but it's it wasn't crickets. You know what I mean? It was fun. No.
There's a couple reasons why you don't want to do that. Yeah. One of them is, unfortunately, when you're starting out, a big part of comedy and getting your stage time and paying your dues is doing those fucking bringer shows.
Yeah.
And I know everyone badmouths bringer shows. And listen, I know they suck. You don't want to have to do them all the time. But in the beginning, you kind of have to do them. When you're sick of doing open mics and you want to perform in front of a real audience and you want to do a show and you want all your friends to see you do a real show, You know, they're going to go, like, can you bring 5 people? Can you bring 10 people? And if you burned all your friends on the open mic when you're doing shitty, and you're not even in, I mean, you did well, but, I mean, you're not in a real show environment. Yeah, no, I get they're not getting the full effect.
Yeah.
And it's not even like they were like, oh, that was so cool. Kevin did so great. You know what I mean? You wasted all your friends going to that when you should have saved them to get you staged quality stage time.
Exactly.
That's a huge mistake. Don't bring your friends. Also, like, don't bring your friends because you want to work out. Don't let people see you fucking try in trials.
Yeah.
You know, you wouldn't have your friend come watch you like play your band in the garage while you guys practice.
Well,
maybe you would. I don't fucking know. Maybe that was a bad analogy. That's
just fun. You just get party and fucking jam.
I'm sure if you came up with some other topics, I'd tell you like what not to do in them.
Yeah. What about crossing the line? Roseanne crossed the line this week.
Yeah. Did she though?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, she did. When you're like the lead star of a show where everybody is depending on this show for like where like you, how many people do you think worked on Roseanne? Like had
so many employees.
Steady jobs and they just got renewed for a second season.
Yeah.
All of a sudden in this day and age, Roseanne just said something. It's not like she hasn't said anything stupid like that before. It just happens to be in this new age where everything is just immediately available.
It was such a stupid decision for her to make.
And I think ABC only canceled it because they knew it went viral.
Yeah.
If it was just something that was rumored and it wasn't, they wouldn't have done anything. Of course. They knew that's why they fucking have Roseanne, because she says stupid shit like that.
And then after that makes that much headline that NBC cancels your show, then her fucking agent dropped her.
Did he?
Yeah, her agency dropped her.
Damn.
It's almost like it's a trend, like, if you didn't drop her as your client after all that happened, you would be like, you're next.
Yeah.
Like they're going to say shit about you. They're going to call you a racist next because you kept her as a client after all that happened.
Absolutely.
It's almost like you have to drop her. So imagine how quick, bro. That was less than 24 hours gone.
Dude, what about...
She's fine, bro.
This Roseanne.
She's going to be fine.
No, but I also heard, would it Paramount take off all reruns of Roseanne so it's not in syndication anymore?
She's already got money.
I know she's already got money, but I'm just saying, like, she ain't going to have no more Roseanne money.
Yeah.
That's fucked up.
Yeah.
What about Morgan Freeman?
He'll be okay.
Because I hear now that there's video evidence of him harassing women.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, have to
I don't know. I mean, like, I'm not going to judge it right there. I'm just saying, like, I didn't have a chance to check it out, but I heard that there is video of it, but I mean,
you
gotta
watch the video and make the judgment call for yourself.
Yeah,
it could just be like he's an old man,
yeah,
and he thinks he's funny, and because he's famous he thinks he can fucking be social. He probably feels pressured to be social with people.
I think it was something where I read the headline real quick. I think it said he was saying, do you like to fool around with older guys to, like, you know.
See, taken out of context, that could be sexual harassment, or it could just be a funny joke.
But do you think he's going to be fine?
Yes.
You think so?
Oh, yeah.
It's Morgan Freeman.
Nothing's bringing him down, dude. Nothing's bringing him down.
Do you think if, like, it was really bad and he went to prison, he would be like how he was in Shawshank? He'd be like the guy that can get you stuff.
Or how cool would it be if him and Cosby were cellmates?
You want a stick of gum or a bag of reefer?
well, you talked about crossing the line.
Yeah,
and
with comedy.
So see if Morgan Freeman was going up to women saying like, you like older men. Honestly, that's a joke. I don't feel like it's over the line.
Yeah.
But again, you'd have to see, like, we'd have to hear the context of how it was.
Well, not only that, when you're doing it on stage is differently because you're making a show of it. But when it's when it's personal one-on-one, that's where it gets kind of creepy.
Yeah. You know how you can just tell when people are just being creepy? Like I mean, was he sitting down at, like, an award show and he grabbed some girl and pulled her to sit down on his lap and he said, hey, do you like older men? That's fucking sexual harassment.
Yeah, yeah.
If he's walking down the street and he's going like, hey, like, you want to come back to my room? And the girl starts walking away and he goes like, what's wrong? Don't you like older men? Like, that's sexual harassment. But, like, if he's, like, having a conversation and joking around with someone, don't you like older men? Like, come on. That's fucking endearing. It's just because of the hype that's going on right now. If like somebody, if you're, you know, somebody's grandfather fucking said that to like somebody. What if like you brought your wife home or a girlfriend to meet your grandfather, right? And you're like, and he's like, oh, hey, Kev, good job there, Kev. She's a pretty one, huh? Does that make him a fucking sexual harasser? And then what if at dinner, what if he keeps making jokes about it all night? You're like, oh, Kevin knows how to pick him.
Yeah.
You know, and then all of a sudden he goes, you got any, what if he goes like, you got a grandmother, a single grandmother or something? What if she goes like, no, but I have a sister. And he goes like, oh, does she like older men? Is that sexual harassment or is he making a fucking joke?
He's making a fucking joke. Come on. Either way, you're still going to look at her and just go, sorry. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. But Roseanne.
That's some fucked up shit she said, dude.
So what are you asking me? Can you cross the line? When is it okay to cross the line?
When is it okay to cross the line? Because I'm sure that like every comic, especially like people who are up and coming, they come up with a joke that's either dirty or like just something like, is this joke, I really like it, but is it crossing the line? Like,
here's what I think it's okay to cross the line. If the joke's funny.
Really?
And it wasn't. Her joke wasn't funny.
No, it wasn't.
It wasn't even remotely close to being relevant.
Uh-huh.
Or fucking funny. Yeah, it wouldn't even have gotten a giggle. if she wasn't famous and she was like a friend of yours that you followed on Facebook or Twitter or whatever and you saw that, you wouldn't even laugh.
Oh, man.
You know? The Kathy Griffith thing, you know?
That was stupid.
That wasn't even funny.
No, it was fucking weird and disturbing.
I think if it's fucking brilliant and it's funny and it's done in the right way. I mean, Chappelle has said some things, bro, on stage in his specials.
Yeah, man, he has.
And he's really brilliant and it's really funny. And I mean, maybe there's because he's so in the spotlight, there's probably a group of people that maybe protested his specials or any stand-up specials that mentioned some topic that they didn't agree with.
That means that's how we know it's worth watching.
Yeah. I mean, you got to – it honestly comes down to being like just common sense or just stupidity.
It's just experience. You have to know where the line is, right?
Yeah, man. Like,
in order to cross it.
You got
to
know your audience. And if you're – excuse me. If you're as big as Roseanne is, you can't even know your audience because there's millions out there. You don't know them all.
Yeah.
You're not performing for them live on a nightly basis or a weekly basis. So why would you think that that's okay to just say that?
That's so stupid.
It almost is like self-sabotage. I almost like half believe that like she wanted to get rid of her show or it's some kind of publicity stunt. I honestly think – a part of me thinks that like she's just dumb. Another part of me thinks that it was she actually wanted out of her show. Or another part of me thinks it was a publicity stunt gone wrong.
Yeah, I bet you, like, psychologically speaking, I mean, like, you have this hit show, and how long was Roseanne first on for? It ended in 97. And then you go through all of life, think it's over. All of a sudden, you're going back, and you're doing the same show again after all these years. I mean, that's just got to be, like... I mean, I'm not giving her any excuses. I'm just talking psychologically speaking that you got to be like – that's got to be kind of surreal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But not like that would give an excuse for her to say what she said. She just seems like a loopy person.
To tell you
loopy
the truth –
loopy people are going to say loopy shit.
What she said, not only was it not funny, it wasn't even really that offensive.
It's just, I mean, well, you got to look at it like this. Everybody has different perspectives on it. People can be, you can't say what people can be offended by because people can be offended by anything.
Yeah, that's true.
But it doesn't mean that they're right.
It doesn't mean that they're right. They're generalizing races now. And then Roseanne came out and said, like, I honestly didn't even know she was black. Like, I was just making a stupid joke. I didn't even know she was black. Whatever the case may be, it just wasn't funny and it's not relevant. And like... If you get offended because she made a comment saying that this girl is ugly and she happens to be black and you are getting offended for all black people, you're generalizing black people. I know a lot of black people that are not fucking ugly. So I don't know about you, but I ain't fucking offended. I'm not black. I mean, I don't think
it's about the ugliness. I think it's about calling her a gorilla.
And so what? Like, that's not pretty. Saying she looks like an animal.
Yeah, I know, but a lot
if you called my white friend and that they look like an animal, like, first of all, if he did look like an animal, that's funny. If he doesn't look like an animal, then I would be offended. You're insulting my friend.
You don't see the racial context behind calling somebody, a black person a gorilla?
If they get mad at that context, you're addressing that you also think that.
No.
Yeah, why would you give them the satisfaction to think that?
You know what I mean? It's like, it's not the same thing, but like using the N-word. I won't say it, but I'm just saying like that. You're just saying, it's just a word, even though it is just a word, but there is like a racial connection to it. You know, people would say black people look like gorillas. Yeah. And so when she said that, that is a racial thing. It's not just an ugly thing. There was a racial thing behind it.
She claims that she didn't know she was black.
Okay. She was on Ambien. She was Ambien tweeting.
Even if she did, bro, I mean, I'm not trying to like defend her or anything like that, but like why you give them the satisfaction to let you know, like, why let it hurt you? It has nothing to do with you. And I mean, I'm not trying to, I don't know, like tell
well,
you
I don't
what
even
to
know th- like what that lady's response was. I think it was just people just saw that and were just so – it doesn't matter how the woman took it.
Well,
it
the
just
woman like later on went
there.
On and like she did like interviews and stuff, and she said like, I don't feel bad for me. Like I feel bad for people out there who are offended, who don't have the support of loved ones and who are – you know what I mean? And stuff like that. It's like whatever, lady. whatever to all of them. All of them go fuck themselves. White, black, I don't give a fuck who the fuck you are. All of you can honestly go fuck yourselves to actually, like, fucking make giant deals out of this fucking crap. Okay? There's fucking people in other countries starving, fucking bleeding, being dragged. You know what I'm saying? That, you know, there's fucking far more issues than I gotta deal with one celebrity thinks of how one politician reminds her of a fucking particular zoo animal. I gotta fuck it. You know what I mean? Fuck them all, dude.
Yeah.
And then NBC canceled the show. Fuck you, NBC. You know exactly what Roseanne is about.
It's ABC.
Sorry, NBC. I take it back. You guys are cool. Fucking ABC knows exactly what the fuck they're up to.
Absolutely. Well, they knew what they were getting with her,
dude,
too.
What do you think Roseanne is? It's about a family of rednecks.
Yeah.
What the fuck did you think was gonna happen? You asked for this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And then you brought it back while Trump's president? What the fuck did you think was going to happen? That's why part of me thinks it's a publicity stunt gone wrong. Because, correct me if I'm wrong. And by the way, I hope this doesn't come across as like defending Roseanne, because I don't give a flying fuck about Roseanne. And I've never been a fan of that show. I've watched a few episodes of that show. I think that show is fucking terrible.
Uh-huh.
I think that is horrible. That was the show when I was up late at night watching TV.
You changed it.
Yeah, you're sitting there watching like something like Three's Company. You know what I mean? Then all of a sudden that ends and like fucking Roseanne comes on. And you're like, ugh. And you change it. That was never a good sitcom.
I will say the only reason
fucking awful.
I still like John Goodman. When I would see him, I would I love John Goodman, but I didn't like Roseanne. My mom watched Roseanne a little bit here and there.
Oh, I thought it was terrible.
Like, it's such a dumb show.
But anyway, I know what the show is. I know what the vibe. I've seen episodes.
Yeah.
You know what it's about. At the time, in the 90s, it was this – correct me for being wrong, if I'm wrong, or forgive me for lack of a better term. It was a family of white trash.
Yeah.
That's what the show is about. And a lot of – people related to it. That's why the show did so well. It is because there's a lot of white trash out there. I mean, there's a lot of fucking people in middle America. It was a bunch of rednecks.
Yeah.
Now they decided to bring back Roseanne. How many fucking other sitcoms could you bring back that would do just as well? They did that shit on purpose. They knew it would be hot right now because of the Trump shit going on. They brought back Roseanne for a specific reason, dude. And have you ever watched one of the more current episodes?
Nope.
They talk about Trump in it. They talk about, like, current events.
Yeah.
And they're, like, a redneck family. And again, I'm not even trying to, like, give you my views on political things. I'm not going to bring it up. I'm not going to tell you, like, who I like and who I don't, if I like him or if I don't. But the point is that the show is about a family of white trash. And when they brought it back, they made it about what's going on in the world today.
Yeah.
So it's had to have been like a publicity stunt that went wrong. Like, she has to probably constantly tweet stuff. She is Roseanne. Her name's Roseanne. The show's fucking named after her. She plays a fucking redneck. So on Twitter, she's out there fucking tweeting shit all the time, and she went a little too far. And then they pulled a plug on her. I guarantee they were all behind it. Guaranteed.
Okay.
You don't think that she got a fucking like phone call the first crazy tweet that she did, and they went like, hey, don't do that. Don't you think ABC was watching her crazy tweets for the past few years, especially during the Trump election, before they gave her show back?
Well, yeah, but, you know, it's – I think it's just because they didn't think it would they didn't think it would be that big of a deal at first.
It's not.
You know what I mean? Like, if like they know she said that stuff, but as long as it wasn't out in the public atmosphere, like on Twitter and people making a big deal out of it, they'll keep it going. That's why they renewed it for season two. And then I think they quickly shut it down because they probably didn't start paying for season two contracts yet. And yeah, so they just cut it down, you know?
Maybe. But I mean, whatever the fuck it is. The joke wasn't even fucking funny.
No, I'm done.
I don't think it was meant to be funny. I think it was just meant for you guys, not you guys. I mean, just meant for the public to be fooled that that's her character. You know what I mean? Like, they're really trying to sell the show. So on Twitter, she has to be that character too. It's a publicity stunt going wrong.
You know, it would be funny if Fox bought Roseanne. If Fox buys Roseanne and puts it back on the air.
But they have, like, to write the scripts, and they just like fucking make her look awful.
That'd be hilarious. Anyway, I'm done talking about
Roseanne. I'm done talking about it too, but yeah, as far as like jokes, me personally, I don't give a fuck what line you cross if it's fucking smart, brilliant, and funny.
Yeah, that's true. Is if you can do it with class and you can, you know what I mean? Especially if you're like a seasoned comic. I feel like people who, like, you know their comedy, you already trust them, you already, you know, you will listen to anything that they have to say.
And some people just have a way of getting away with certain things that others don't.
Yeah.
Like sometimes I'll write with Joey, and sometimes, you know, we'll write together. And then sometimes I'll take a bit that him and I are working on together. It's his bit, and I'll take it and do an open mic, and I'll try it verbally. It helps me write it out, and I can figure out what's wrong there, punch it up, things like that. And when he does it, fucking kills. When I do it, it doesn't work because it was like sexual stuff or something, like a little raunchy or dirty or something like that. And like, people looked at me like they were so offended. But when he does it, it's fine.
Yeah.
He's older. He just has a way of getting away with it.
His shows, like, people go there to see his shows. It's not like the club is just...
No, but I've seen him like just working it out at little rooms too, where no one even knew he was going to be there. He just popped in.
Well, those jokes match his personality and presence, you know?
Yeah, he can get away with it. I couldn't. I mean, if you're going to try and cross a line, guys, fucking better be worth it.
Not only that, if you're going to cross the line, you better be prepared to get, you know, shot. Take the flack. Take all the fucking bad shit that comes with it. Otherwise, if you're not prepared to do that, don't fucking cross the line.
If you have as many eyes on you as Roseanne, different story. If you're an up-and-coming comic... no publicity is bad publicity.
Yeah, that's right.
So if you're an up and coming comic, you got like fucking 1,500 followers on Twitter, and fucking 10 of them are like, "Oh my god, that's sex ass." It's still good publicity for you. It's not enough to hurt you, and it actually just got your name out there more.
And people are starting to want to get to the root of these issues. Like, what happened? Let me see. Oh, that guy's not that bad. That's funny what he said. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
If you're like worried about offending people in a comedy show, I wouldn't blame you about being worried about that. Again, like, you just kind of have to kind of like use common sense,
which a lot of people lack.
Yeah, it's totally true. Like, why would you think that would be okay to talk about? I understand.
Can you think of any time when you saw somebody just do something incredibly stupid on stage?
I couldn't remember word for word, but like, I have seen guys just do like. It's like pointless bits. Like, there's not even like a huge punchline. It was just like offensive, just to be offensive. Like, they thought that they came up with something offensive and it was going to be edgy and it would just be so brilliant because it's different. But it had no punchlines, though, and there was no point of even offending anybody.
Yeah.
Like, it was – I mean, I've heard guys talk about, like, abortions and really – like, some abortion jokes are fucking funny.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. Like, that could be a very sensitive topic, and sometimes you can cross the line with abortion jokes. Even I could think so. But if you have a way of making it, like – first of all, if it's super fucking funny or smart or well-executed – gives a fuck. It's
I remember one time we were doing you were doing a show, and it was at some, like, hotel basement, I think, and there was this one comic on there, and he was just so raunchy and, like, just to be, like, it was disgusting,
yeah.
But it wasn't even funny. It was just, there's like,
no point. That's what I'm
it
saying.
It was just, like, this
I know
asshole,
exactly who and when you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, but it was just like, well, what the, that's not funny. Just be.
Yeah, there's not even a point to your story, for, number one, and there's no punchline either.
Yeah, it's just, like, taking every single thing that you could make fun of, like, trannies, fucking orphans, fucking weird shit. Just like,
if it was funny, I would not get offended at all.
Yeah, if it's funny, it's funny.
I don't even mind raunchy comedy. If it's dirty, if it's sexual or whatever, if you fucking hit a hammer or hit the nail on the head with the hammer, bro, I'm like, fucking dude, I'm dying.
Yeah,
because even though you don't, oh, I'm clean, I don't like dirty humor, I don't give a fuck who you are, you're a human being and you fuck, right?
Yeah,
if somebody hits like something that you related to so much, like, oh my god, that happens to me and my wife. And it's not you haven't really heard that someone else talk about it out loud before. It's fucking funny.
Yeah.
If it's executed well, I don't give a shit. I don't give a shit if you want to talk about religion. I don't care if you want to talk about fucking sex. But yeah, I've heard guys with like abortion, rape.
Yeah. That's a no-no for me. I don't talk about that.
That's a fucking no-no. But you know what, bro? I've even heard a rape joke that was funny. That was like, ah, you got to leave that one in, bro. That was fucking good.
Oh, damn.
But then, like, yeah, I can remember guys that, like, kind of, like, incorporated rape, cancer, and abortion all in one bit. And there was no point to do so. It wasn't like it all went and flowed with a good story, no punchlines. It was just a purpose to be edgy and raunchy.
Yeah, I hate
that. That was their thing. Their most important thing to them was to make people raise their eyebrows. And you're just offending. Speaking of which, I tried a joke that I probably shouldn't have in front of a certain amount of people.
What was it? Do you not want to say it?
No, I'll tell you.
Okay.
So I was going to tell you about this. So last week I had to go do a career day at a middle school.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me that. What happened? Because it's funny because I work in schools.
Yeah.
And the shit kids say in that is fucking hilarious.
So my aunt is a teacher at a middle school, and she asked me to come if I would come for a career day. And I was surprised that she asked me because her husband's a fucking cop. I'm like, why don't you get him to do it? But apparently he was like, he didn't want to do it. So
he didn't want to make all the black kids in class nervous.
Nowadays, that's not even like a show and tell no more. Yeah. A cop walks in, everyone just hides under the desk. See, that might have offended some people, but
I can't even tell you how many times I've seen the cops in school this year. It's crazy.
Really?
Yep.
Aren't they supposed to just walk through anyway every now and then?
No, I'm talking about being called specifically for the school.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
But I'm not going to get any details.
Yeah. So anyway, so I'm like, yeah, I'll do it. I don't know what I was getting myself into, man. Because then, like, she hooks me up with, like, the vice principal or whatever, the guy who's organizing it. And he, like, sends me, like, the times.
Yeah,
I guess it's all the different classes, and he's like, you know, select which ones you can do. And I'm like, it was like, it's like 8 a.m. to 12:30, and I'm like, fuck it, I'll do all of them. I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
I just clicked it on them all, and I always pictured like,
did they make you do all of them?
Yes.
What?
So I pictured it to be, you ever see the movie City Slickers?
Yep.
Do you remember in the beginning, like when the parents were all there and Billy Crystal felt shitty about his lame job?
Yes.
I pictured it like a bunch of parents sitting on the
sidelines.
So you're
like Santa Claus?
No, you know, like, I pictured just like a classroom, a bunch of parents sitting on the sidelines, and we took turns going up one by one, and we talked for like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
No. The guy goes, then he emails me and he goes, we're going to do, he goes, we're going to do 30 minutes. And he goes, I feel like that's about as much the attention span the students are going to have. And I went like, oh, okay, so like how much am I doing?
Is this like a stand-up show? Did you just do a stand-up show at a fucking school?
Bro, listen, I'll tell you. I didn't have to do one. I didn't do one.
Well, what grades were these
kids? I did
kids?
Six periods.
What grades?
This was grade – I did four like, through seven, I want to say.
Oh, boy.
Grades 4 through 7. So – so I'm like, yeah, so how long am I doing, though? And he's like, 30 minutes. And I'm like, oh, so I'm not sharing the 30 minutes with other, like, speakers? And they're like, no, you're doing the whole 30 minutes.
What?
So I guess they had other volunteers, but they just sent them to different classrooms. So I had fucking six different classrooms, and I had to do 30 minutes each in front of them.
Wait, so that you didn't. So you did 30 minutes, and then you went to another classroom, did another 30 yes. minutes, and then you did. That's insane.
Yes, from 8 a.m. to 12:30.
That's crazy. Why would you do that?
Well, she asked me to do it, and I felt like I would volunteer my time.
Okay.
Also, I agreed to it when I was going through the writer's block, and I thought, and you told me to do something you've never done before.
Oh, that's right. There you go.
So I was like, I don't know. Let me go give this a try and just see what it's like. So, dude, I kind of like wrote out like what I would talk about.
Wait, were you going there for as stand-up, right?
Career day for stand-up, yeah. I just figured I mapped out kind of what I would start with, like, you know, hey guys, like, I'm a stand-up comic. Like, I started when I was 20. I've been doing it 10 years now. And then, like, I'd probably tell them about like some of the cool shows I've written for or been on or cool comics I've worked with. And I'll take some questions and hopefully, like, you know, stuff like that. I even got, like, pictures. I brought my iPad.
Yeah.
And I put some, like, really cool pictures of me and, like, famous comics and guys I got to work with. I showed them some pictures of shows.
Yeah.
You know, little hidden messages. I'm like, if you work hard, you know, you can have your name in lights one day. And I showed them, like, pictures of my name on the marquee at the Comedy Store and stuff that. It was pretty cool. What else? I try to have, like, little hidden messages in there and, like, how you should you know, follow your dreams, things like that. You know, I always tell them, like, if you really, really love something and if you're passionate about it, always do it. Never stop doing it. And I'm like, even if you have like a full-time job or if you're in school and people are telling you, well, you have to do this as your career. I know that that's your passion, but this is your career. I'm like, always never stop doing your passion.
Yeah.
As long as you're in school or your job, whatever you're doing. I'm like, always do it as long as you love it. Right. Things like that. I try to tell them, like, you know, just follow your hearts, follow your dreams, don't ever give up type of shit. Man, some of the kids, like, certain grades, like, the younger ones are, like any questions, they'll just stare at you. And I'm guys, we got, like, 18 minutes left. No questions. Like, they're all just fucking staring at me, like, anything.
I'm like, oh, man, that's school these days.
I asked them, do you guys – I think this is a pretty good question, like, especially to ask kids. I asked them, like, do you guys think that – yeah, you have to have an education to be a stand-up comedian. Why are you laughing? Do you think that's cheesy?
No, I think it's funny that the teacher's like, okay, that's enough out of you. The kids need an education.
No, I didn't say it like sarcastically.
You guys want to drop out of school and go on tour with me?
I just said, so what do you guys think? Like, let me ask you guys a question. Do you guys think you have to have an education to be a stand-up comedian? And they all were like, no. And then I was like, you're right. You don't have to. But I told him it will make things really easy for you later on. And I'm like, you never know. You might end up writing for some TV shows or something. It's great to know. Like you know, if you like writing, it's great to take classes on it. English classes, like writing classes, script writing. And I'm like, and I told him, like I'll go back and like regret that I didn't get a college degree. And I told him, like, you know, I've even gone back and taken, like, history courses just to, like, try to get, like, material. I'm like, the more you widen your knowledge, the more capable you are of having material.
Yeah.
And writing smart and standing out from everybody else. So I kind of, like, let him know that it is important. Why are you laughing?
Because it sounds like you were slowly breaking down in front of these kids. I never did anything smart in school. I never went to college. And you just started crying and peeing in the corner.
One little girl in one of the classrooms, not little, she was maybe like, I don't know, fucking 12. I don't know what grade that was. She raised her hand and she's like, do you ever feel resentment towards people that are doing better than you in your career?
Oh, man.
And I was just like, look at you and your little questions. All right, let's get back to it. Like, I just like ignored her.
Dude, you know what's kind of funny? Even like some kids, they know how to say the shit that can just go right to your soul.
Yeah.
What, like, there was this jackass kid. I mean, like, he had some, like, really fucking behavior problems, and he was a bit of a bully, you know, and like he would try to intimidate the teachers. And then one day he comes up to me and just looked at me, and like I could tell that he wanted to say something that hurt me. And then he just looked at me and he just goes, you're old. And then he walked away, and I'm like, oh my god, he's right. That was awful. Why did you say? How did he
That's
know?
That's so weird.
Because he was like swearing at somebody else, and he's using foul language. I'm like, what's this little kid gonna say to me? He just comes up to me, just looks at me, and he just sizes me up, and goes, "You're old."
He got
And then
you,
he just
bro.
Walked away, and I just went, "Oh."
He
shit.
Picked you apart.
He fucking got me right in the soul. He kicked my soul in the nuts.
He saw right through your fears.
It was crazy.
Well, at least you weren't even asking him, though.
No, I wasn't.
I was asking these kids questions. And shit. But you know what? I thought that was for her age. That was a really good question. Some of them didn't have questions. Some of them had like basic questions, like they're just like, I don't know, like, who have you met famous? You know, things like that. But like, some of them had like some really good questions. I thought that was one of them. I didn't expect them to ask me anything like that.
That's funny. See, like the older kids, like I work with a lot of the younger ones, like the kindergarten through like third grade, usually fourth grade, and the shit they say is pretty funny, but it's like kindergarten funny.
Yeah.
Like this, like I asked this little kid, I'm like, hey, what's your favorite shape? It's like dinosaur. Yeah. So, okay.
It was funny to see like the different ages and how everybody acts, and there was one like the, I think they were like seventh graders or sixth graders or something, and the teacher was like, just to give you a heads up before this class walks in here right now, she goes, this is my worst period of the day. And she's like, these guys are pretty rowdy.
Yeah.
And she's like, whatever happens, don't worry about it. You're doing fine.
And what happened?
They were actually okay. Like, they were a little loud and rowdy, but, like...
It's like, I deal with hecklers all day long. Yeah, Come on, lady.
Kids are different than hecklers.
Did you accidentally let an F-bomb drop?
No, not at all.
Oh, my God. No. I swore in front of a kid once by accident.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. I thought I was going to get fired on the spot.
Someone heard you?
Nope, but that was just my immediate thought.
Well... Now it's so interesting how like, because they probably heard like a bunch of other careers that day that were maybe a little more boring,
mm-hmm.
but it's so funny how like kids' attention span, because like when they first stood up there, the teacher is always like, "This is, you know, Agostino Zoida is going to tell you about his career today," and like they probably already saw a couple other careers that day, and they're all like, "Okay," like all bored and shit. And then I'm like, hey, guys, like, I'm a stand-up comic. And they're all like, whoa, cool. Like, everyone, like, woke the fuck up. But by, like, 5 minutes into me talking, they were like, this just sounds like a fucking job. Like, because after they would ask, like, questions and stuff, they'd be like, this doesn't sound like it's so fun. And I would tell them, like, it's not all fucking fun. Like, it's hard work. Like, you got to wake up early. You can't sleep until noon like people think comics can.
I wish I could have signed up for there. And then I just would have said... I am a regional salesperson for Dunder Mifflin. I sell paper.
You're stupid.
Yeah, I am stupid. But that's funny. I'm glad you had a fun time.
Well, so here's the thing. So, like, without fail, every class asks me the same question. Okay. Can you tell us a joke? And I even broke it down because that was some of the things that they told us in the school to go over, like how many different types of jobs or styles or careers are there in your business. So I told them like that you can do this with this career, you can do that. I told them like, you know, how different styles of comedy there were. Some people tell jokes, some people tell stories. Tell all the kids all this stuff, and they would just ask me like, well, can you tell us a joke? And I went like, well, remember I told you about different styles earlier? I'd be like, I don't really do quick jokes. I'm like, I do them like stories or longer bits.
Yeah, do one of those.
Yeah, they're like, yeah, can you do one of those? I'm like, I don't really think we have time, guys, stuff like that. And at first I kept saying like, you know what, guys, I didn't run any of my material by the school, and I probably should get approval. I'm like, I don't know what is okay to talk about. And they would all go, oh man, stuff like that. And then the last like few classes was all my aunt's class. They put me with her like most of the day, so that was fine. So like, she told me, like, towards the end of the day, she's like, you can tell them one if you want to, if you have time left over. So I was like, are you sure? She's like, as long as it's not dirty. I'm like, I would never say anything dirty to the kids. And she's like,
you guys ever be going down on a chick, right?
Yeah. I'm like, come on. Like, I mean, I'm like, I don't know if it's going to be funny to them in a classroom, if it's going to translate their longer bits.
I want
to
know what kind of what bit did you do?
Okay, so hold on. Fucking get into it, bro. So, dude, the first one that I did. I don't even know how it came up. We just started talking. I don't know why we were talking about. Oh, I was telling them about how I've taken different classes to broaden my material. I told them like I went back and took a history class. I even took a Bible history class because sometimes you learn some stories you didn't know about and you might come up with some material about it. It's just good to educate yourself on things. And they were like, "Can you tell us one of the jokes about Bible study?"
Okay.
And that was right after I had talked to my aunt, who was like, if you have time next time, do a joke if it's not dirty. And I'm like, okay. And he's asking me, like, can we hear one? So I did this thing that I've been working on about the story of Noah's Ark. And I told them, like, again, this is why I shouldn't be doing, like, I don't do jokes, quick jokes that a kid will get. And it's something I'm working on. And I was like, guys, the story about Noah's Ark, you know, God decided that he wanted to, like, wipe out the planet and start all over again with just Noah and his family and, like, two of every animal. So he told him to build an ark, and then he had, like, a flood and like, took everybody out. That's, like, what happened. And I said, the craziest part about that story to me is how come we're all still here? Like, how horrible were those people that God took them out, but we're okay?
You got deep with these kids, man. You didn't even try to do funny. You went straight religions.
That was, yes. And like, because he asked me, what was the joke you came up with about religion?
Okay, that's funny.
And I'm like, well, that's it. And that is something that I'm working on. It is kind of deeper. And I was just like, I'm like, what were they doing that was so bad back then that we haven't done worse yet? You know, and I'm like, did they have like a Kardashian back then? You know what I mean? Like, and a Kanye, and then like the kids all kind of like looked at each other like really weirded out, like, and then afterwards I was like, should I not have told the joke? And my aunt was like, you probably shouldn't talk about religion.
That reminds me of something that I heard my dad say once. It was something that really just like angered him about the Bible, and he's talking to me. He's like, this is something I'll never fucking understand. All right, Cain and Abel, the son of Adam and Eve, right? Cain and Abel.
Yeah.
Cain kills Abel, and because Adam and Eve are the first people that God made, they're the first people. Cain kills Abel. They send Cain to go live with other people. Who the fuck are these other people if they're the first two people ever made?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
And if they only had two sons, how did more people continue? Yeah,
that's exactly.
Bro, if you do some Bible study classes, there's all kinds of material in there. That's
crazy shit. But I think our podcast is done when we start talking about religion.
Yeah. Then the next class, I decided to do a more kid-friendly bit. And I did like a longer bit for them. I had some time left over. They were all like, come on, like, tell us something. I'm like, all right. I got permission. I don't do religion. I'm going to keep it clean. I did a bit I'm working on. Well, actually, no, this one's like pretty much done. I did a bit about my nephew and how I kind of like don't agree that kids should have smartphones.
Yeah.
And like the problems that kids have and how kids get lazy with like their technology and stuff like that. So I have like a couple bits about that. Some of it I had to leave out because some of it is dirty.
Yeah.
And some of it I do curse. But I did like the parts that were clean about it. About like making fun of video games compared to my video games when I had. And they really liked that. And then, like, right towards, like, the last part, I was, like, right about to hit, like, the big punchline, the bell rang. And all the kids were like, oh, man. Like, they were actually, like, into it. They were, like, I was actually getting, like, fucking real laughs from that bit for them. I was, like, doing, like, a full 5 minutes for them.
That's funny.
And then the teacher was like, you can finish the bit. You can finish the bit. And I finished it. They were like, oh, that's funny.
That's cool.
It's pretty funny, dude.
Good for you.
But I'm glad that we got to here, let me read my shout-outs first.
Yeah, get your shout-outs going on, dude.
And then I'll continue. I want to give a shout-out to my dear friend Diana Darling.
Hey, Diana.
I want to give a shout-out to the other voices.
The other voices.
That's my girl. We're wishing you a speedy recovery here at Homeschooled Podcast.
That's right. What's wrong with her? Is she okay?
She had a surgery, and she's just trying to get back up on her feet.
Well, get better. Thanks for listening.
I want to give a shout-out to Kenneth. Or on Twitter, it's KLindo32.
KLindo!
I want to give a shout-out to MGTOW Aussie.
What up, MGTOW?
Shug7595. That's my dude.
What's up, Shug?
Jeffrey Collins. How are you, buddy? Thanks for listening. I want to give a shout-out to Talk to Cleo, to Miss Cleo there. Thank you so much for just the support and shout outs through the years and just being cool and always mentioning me and stuff on Twitter. Chad Bowser. It's Bowser. Honestly, I think I'm reading my own handwriting wrong. It might be Bolster. Anyway, thank you for the support, Chad. Steven Krypton.
What's up, Krypton?
I want to give a shout-out to always supporting the podcast, Grandpa Nicotine.
What's up, Grandpa Nicotine? Sucking down those cigarettes?
My dude, the White Mamba.
What's up, White Mamba?
And also, I want to give a shout-out to a good buddy of ours. It was on the podcast, funny comic, Rick Ramos.
What's up, Rick?
Who I've just been running into a lot lately. Cool dude. And make sure you check out his – we had him on when we talked about movies. Have him, check out his podcast, Watch This. With Rick Ramos.
Cool.
And that's pretty much it. Yeah, Kev, I'm glad that you and I got to do a podcast again, just you and me.
I kind of want to I think we talked about this. I want to make these the solo ones of just me and you just a lot more fun. Maybe have some games or do something fun.
We might do that.
That'd be fun.
Do something
like
different.
Some joke telling.
Each time it's just you and me on the podcast, we might do
something a little bit more special to get people excited.
But the last time, maybe two or three episodes ago, it was just me and you, and we talked about how I had writer's block.
Yeah.
And we even talked about like some of the bits that I was going over in my head and I was going to try them and stuff. And so I just kind of wanted to like recap of what's going on the last couple of weeks with me. Writer's block's been kind of away for the most part.
There you go.
I've also been like remembering old things that happened to me, remembering a little bit from my past and thinking like that could be a possible bit because it's something unique. And even if it's not, I'm just glad my brain is remembering it and taking it to the stage and I'm trying stuff.
Yeah.
And two of those bits that we talked about that day are currently working.
There you go, buddy.
Especially the story about when I first started dating my wife and she had the Vaseline next to there.
Oh, that's funny.
She was into anal. That story is really working. I need to add some more punchlines in there. One that we didn't talk about that day, but I told you about, is the ice cream bit that I'm working on
right
now.
Oh, I like that. That's a good one.
Fucking bombing right now, bro.
It's not doing well?
It's not doing well. I haven't been able to make it do well once.
That's funny. I like that bit.
That's weird. Anyway.
It happens.
Working on this bit about like all these hipster ice cream shops that are opening up and why do people think they had to change ice cream? What was wrong with it before? What else? I talk about how I'm old school with my ice cream. I like chocolate chip and fucking Rocky Road and pistachio. And I go to get my ice cream from Thrifty's, which is inside Rite Aid. Like, that's where I get my ice cream from. It's cheaper. You get your scoops.
You a basic bitch.
I'm like breathing on the glass, like all excited. I talk about how so it's a bit because it's got three parts all about the same topic, and the third one is about how they have healthy ice cream now, and people always try to sell me on that. Like, one of my favorite ice creams is pistachio, and I'm like, oh, dude, I can go for a pistachio ice cream right now, and someone will tell me, like, have you tried Halo? And the stores are like, it's only like 280 calories, and it tastes exactly like the same thing, and I'm like, no, it fucking doesn't. It doesn't taste anything like it at all. Like, if ice cream companies figure out how to make ice cream exactly the same but be healthier, everyone will be doing it.
It's
it doesn't
like,
taste
it's
the same.
It's like when people watch the Ghostbusters reboot with the girls and then just like, it was funny. It was just as good. It's just as good as
no,
the first
was it?
No, it wasn't.
No, it wasn't. Fucking Halo ice cream.
I don't care.
Stop
I'm going to watch this one.
Telling me it's delicious and healthy. It might be less calories, but it ain't fucking delicious.
Yeah.
And this is another thing that I'm using on stage. I'm saying, that Halo ice cream, that healthy ice cream, it tastes like someone poured regular ice cream in the mouth of like a hipster and they shook it up for like 5 minutes and then they spit it into your bowl. That's what that ice cream tastes like. It's not really working because I think that people actually
it
really
all smells
do
like carpet.
A lot of people like that healthy ice cream. They like these new like trendy ice cream shops opening up around town. Fuck. They like paying $10 for a bowl of ice cream. I don't know. That bitch just not working.
Give me some mint chocolate chip and a cone, bitch.
So yeah, it's been going good. The writer's block has kind of kicked. I'm trying more things, and that's it. I'm glad I got to tell you, catch you up on my past couple of weeks and my progress.
Well, I know it was bothering you and it was stressing you out. So
yeah,
it's good that you're finally at one with your joke writing.
Yeah, it's going good.
There you go, buddy.
I don't know what else I got coming up this week. Doing some show in Century City. I don't really have the details on that yet. On the 8th, it's a weekend. Once I have details on that, I'll be posting about it, or I'll tell you guys on here. I'm going to be in Bakersfield June 29th. I'll have more details on that coming up. It's actually going to be me and Lee Syatt
are going.
Oh, nice.
So I'm going to go have
to. We got to get Lee back on. I like
Yeah, for sure. I'll headline it, and then I'll have I'm having Lee come with me and open it up.
Cool.
And if I get anything else, I'll let you guys know about it. Thank you so much for listening. Don't forget to go to bullymake.com. Hook your doggy up with a fun little box of treats and toys. Use the promo code HOME, H-O-M-E, to get $10 off your order. And freshroastedcoffee.com, organic fresh roasted coffee delivered to your door, either pods or the grounds. And you're going to use the promo code SCHOOL to get 10% off. And don't forget to go check out a watch for yourself, for your father, for a gift, just to have a unique novelty item. Click the link, dmcwatch.com, the specific link in the description. That's pretty much it, Kevin.
Nice, buddy.
Keep in touch. We love the feedback, you guys, on Twitter, Instagram, or wherever you put it. So please keep doing it. Or if you haven't already, please do so. What else are they going to say? Kevin's Twitter is @TheRealKevLyons. On Twitter and Instagram, I'm @AugustinoZoida on Twitter and Instagram. And please, guys, don't forget to go to iTunes and give us a 5-star rating and a good compliment. And subscribe, or wherever you're listening to this, make sure you subscribe, tell a friend, whatever you got to do. And make sure you go to the YouTube channel, AugustinoZoida, where I'm posting these episodes, and subscribe.
Cool.
That's it.
Awesome. We did it. Good job, buddy. You got an outro song or what?
What do you think?
Of course.
I had like stand-up bits queued up.
We didn't even play that'd be kind of fun.
Hold on. One of my favorite – don't worry. It's 39 seconds.
That's cool. I like it.
One of my favorite fucking stand-up jokes of all time from Bill Cosby. It's only 39 seconds.
7 through 15, I thought my name was Jesus Christ.
I remember this. This is funny.
Dude, it's really one of my funny. Favorite jokes of all time still. Yeah. I don't care how many chicks he raped. That's one of my
it's
favorite
really funny.
Fucking jokes. All right, you guys, thank you so much for listening to the Homeschool Podcast. And that's it. It's always great to have you here in the garage, everybody. Thanks for stopping by.
Yeah.
We'll see you next time.
We'll see you next time, guys. Thanks.
I'm stalling because I'm waiting for the fucking music to play. It's the newest one.
Yeah.
I like this one.
Yeah, I have the whole album. Oh,
yeah.
There's some good songs on it.
You know what we should do one time when it's just me and you? We should either play stand-up bits, and then pause. After the bit is over, we just talk about it, analyze it, if we liked it, if we didn't like it, why we liked it, how we relate to it.
That's cool.
Pick it apart as like a joke.
That'd be fun.
Or even like a stand-up special and like pause it in between, like
yeah.
Someone special.
Like reviewing somebody.
Probably better do that if they were on.
Nah, we'll do it with like different clips, different people's jokes.
It's definitely worth exploring to see what we can do.
Yeah.
Oh, it's like a gift battle.
Yeah. You got like a minute left.